Greetings, respected jury members. We are Team Sigma from the Indian Institute of Management, Raipur, India. I am Chirag Gupte.
I am Giridhar Menbaka.
I am Vaibhav Binde.
And we are delighted to bring you the case, our solution to the case. So let's look at the first question, why BOC's profit is not growing at the same rate as revenue. Now, there are certain reasons which are already given in the case, such as the high demand and supply variability, the inability to push substitute organic products as they've tried previously, significant holding costs due to refrigeration and losses due to the perishability. Now we dug a little deep and tried to find out what might be the motivations of customers to prefer refrigerated products over fresh products. So first of all, we found that it might be a lack of awareness on the customer's part, because they might prefer purchasing fresh SKUs. Now we are assuming that BOC has two sets of SKUs. One is fresh, one which are sold fresh, and one which are refrigerated. And so customers might prefer buying the fresh ones because they might perceive that these fresh SKUs have a better nutritional value, whereas this is not the case. In fact, refrigerated products retain a lot of nutritional value. So there's a need to make aware customers. And the second one is that the limited information that is available to customers about this. So it may be the information about the expiry date, about the nutritional information, etc. on the packaging, which might be dissuading them from purchasing this. So this might be leading to greater wastage, because fresh SKUs have a higher degree of wastage, as well as the non-purchase of refrigerated goods, which again leads to their perishability. So it all is being, the brunt is being borne by BOC.
Coming to the second question, does demand sensing improve purchasing and sourcing activities? What we believe is demand sensing in this particular scenario doesn't help a purchasing and sourcing activities, because if you look into demand sourcing, it is basically reduction in uncertainty by using current demand signals. And BOC's purchasing program is such that it is very meticulous and time consuming and very selective. So if this particular purchasing and sourcing activity should be held because of the demand sensing sensitization, it should be robust enough so that it can cater to the proliferation of the data information that is being provided by the sensitization of the demand sensing program. So to have a demand sensing work, BOC should have to have developed the robust network, along with having initiatives that will empower the suppliers. And profitability, if you are looking into it, has two aspects, that are inefficiencies in the supply chain and the delays that are happening in the supply chain. So demand sensing would help smoothing the forecast differences, but not completely increase the profitability.
One of the key issues of BOC was a high demand variability. Because of this, BOC was facing a lot of problems in high holding cost, high setup cost, and though their revenue was increasing, but still their profit was very low. So what is the solution for that? So we come to in a conclusion of worldwide multi-hub for BOC. So this is the world map, and for convenience, we consider a single factory for processing and packaging of organic product. So this factory is located at this location. Now at near to the factory, we created a hub. We call that as a central warehouse. Now according to people's preferences, their habit, SKU preferences, and the other factor, we analyze the complete world and divided the complete world into three international warehouses. Those warehouses are located at this location, and this location. Now these international warehouses are further divided into a regional country warehouses. And all these locations, we are creating a buffer for providing a good demand variability. So in the next slide, we are actually analyzing the country level multi-hub model for BOC, how it will work and how it will damp the variability to a certain level. So basically, these are the three locations. These are the three locations for we consider as the country regional warehouses. These regional warehouses are connected with the state distribution center. Now these state distribution center is connected to the retail houses. Every of these locations are have their own buffers. Now we analyze the complete supply chain at country level in this way. Actually, we create one simulation. We assume certain data. And through data, we realize that the coefficient of variation at each retail store is around at this level. It's around in the range of 30% to 40%. When we put a state distribution warehouse to damp that variability, we came to the result of 9.44% as a total coefficient of variation. also apply the same model at regional warehouse level. We actually mitigate the demand variability of state distribution center at regional warehouse. So what are those results? Before applying a decoupling hub at state distribution center, our coefficient of variation was around in the range of 30 to 35%. After applying a decoupling hub, we reduced that coefficient of variation by 60 to 65%. In the similar manner, when we apply a decoupling hub at regional country level warehouses, we further damp that coefficient of variation at around 44 to 55%. So what is the overall result at the country level? Is it efficient or not? Is it efficient? Actually, if you consider the overall reduction in coefficient of variation from retailer to country's regional warehouses, it was around 86 to 89% according to this simulation. Further, we adjusted for the assumption. We considered the assumption factor of 20% and came to the result of 89 to 71% in the reduction of coefficient of variation. So, what are the other benefits? The first major benefit is compressed total lead time. The second major problem is the better utilization of the resources. The third is increased service level. As the product, the SKUs are available at the retailer stores at the perfect time when consumer wants it. Also, because of the better utilization of resources, increased service level, there is a huge reduction in cost, and definitely it will benefit the company's profitability. Should inventory positioning strategy and replenishment strategy of BOC link or not? We recommended it should be linked, and how BOC will achieve it. So there are two important factors. The first is strategic inventory positioning and calculation of the buffer. We actually did it through the multi-hub configuration model. And the second is the high speed of flow of relevant information and material. Also, we created a hypothetical situation where we analyzed the inventory before creating a multi-hub model and after creating a multi-hub model. We found that the total reduction in inventory was around 40 to 50%. For the overall supply chain.
And to look at the technology solutions that BOC can adopt to counter these trade challenges, we can look into trade challenges as a part that trade challenges comes from the re-verification process, where the re-verification is important to different parties and the verification is a thorough process. So for that, to counter those difficulties, what BOC can do is to have a technology that is a platform based, so that there could be integration among all the parties and there could be trust that can build upon the particular using technology. So what we are trying to suggest is to have either a cloud-based solution or to have a blockchain technology. We are looking particularly into blockchain. So we are looking at few examples that we have that are utilizing the blockchain in particular, where we have Walmart Food Traceability Initiative that was launched in September 2018. And similarly, Maersk had a big paperwork issue in 2014, where there were important documents that were misplaced that were found again back in 2018. This handling is really making the trade process very tedious. So what Maersk did was to come into collaboration with IBM, and they have created something called Maersk IBM Global Trade Digitalization Initiative. Under this initiative, earlier all the Maersk's activities were disorganized, as you can see on the left, and in future they try to integrate each and everything with the global trade digitalization platform. And looking into the cost of implementation that blockchain essentially requires, it is not feasible for BOC as an organization, but if they can partner with some other conglomerates or consortiums, it will be really important. If we want to calculate the ROI in particular, we have a framework that is established with reference to the IBM network as well. We'll be looking into benefits, that will be looking into new opportunity and that are solving existing pain points. Then the costs that are involved, costs involving the pilot phase, the commercialization phase and the ongoing phase. And the aspects that are there in the pain points are cost avoidance and savings and the efficiencies. And in cost avoidance and savings, we are trying to reduce the capital expenditure and the operation expenditure investment. And through efficiency, we are trying to look into the improved processes. And here we have particularly mentioned the benefits and costs. And the costs in particular, from an example we have taken, the IBM report has a pilot phase of 0.5 million and a commercialization phase of 2.2 million. And ongoing within a 5-year span, we can expect an investment of 3 million. So, but the benefits that are there, the benefits are not particularly directly monetary, but rather indirect. And these values will be implemented when your transaction passes through. So the best way for BOC to implement blockchain is to outsource it to consortiums and not buy it for their own.
One of the problem of BOC was a lack of awareness among the consumer. So to tackle that, we came with a campaign called as Scan the Box. Basically, we are replacing the old packaging with smart packaging with dynamic QR code. That QR code will consist of the basic information along with the origin, different certifications related to the product. Actually, whenever consumer came into the retail store, they will scan this QR code and QR code will redirect to them to the product information page. At the same time, a pop-up will generate and that pop-up will tell a consumer to refer this product to the other one. While doing that, they have to enter a mail ID, and for reward, BOC will offer a particular discount to this particular consumer at POS of the retailer.
Now let us look at the final recommendations to BOC to improve BOC results. We have developed a 6-year plan with 6 initiatives for each of the years. Though each of these initiatives will be launched and in subsequent years, all of the work will start within the first year. So it will start with the first Scan the Box campaign, which is a QR code and app campaign. So this will be started with a pilot initially and then deployed for maximum impact in each of the different geographies. This has been already discussed. The advantages would be more awareness and information transparency, etc. Then we'll also outsource the logistics and warehousing to 3PL providers because they have better competency at managing that, and the cost for that will go down. They'll be able to there will be better inventory positioning and replenishment as we discussed previously. As well as we can tie up with other manufacturers who are using the 3PL logistics to make joint use of our cold supply chain as well as their cold supply chain, so that the cost would be distributed. Another thing would be improved service levels, lower costs, etc. Another thing that can be done in connection with the application that we have previously developed is to enter the omni-channel with e-commerce. So we will be shipping to areas near our retail stores which are there, and also near office hubs where the demand for organic produce will be high. Now we will also tie up with existing food delivery aggregators who would be able to deliver to areas much more efficiently. This will be promoted over social media as well. And it would also lead to better transparency on the part of the customer's side for BOC, and it would also lead to better forecasting. And it will also attract new customers and drive growth. The next thing that once the last mile is covered with these three initiatives locally, we'll also be trying to integrate with a global supply chain consortium who has cloud and blockchain capabilities. The main motive for doing this would be to enhance traceability, flexibility, and responsiveness throughout our global supply chain. It will also help us to take care of variable shipping times, changes in trade policy, delays in clearances, etc. And currently, we will only be looking at those consortiums who would have a capability of blockchain in the future, because we would like to have those capabilities in the future. And it will also, finally, the main objective would be reduce time and cost for clearances. The next thing that we will be looking forward to is developing and supporting farmers who are our suppliers and to go global. So this involves, first of all, our farmers who are suppliers for our organic produce. We will be giving them access to loans, insurance, agri-inputs, agri-advisory services, etc. so that they can grow themselves and it will empower them as well. So this will give a partnership between BOC and the farmers, which will benefit both. It will also reduce the supply uncertainty from their side, because they'll be able to manage their produce better. And it will also, the partners which are involved in this, they'll be able to develop the infrastructure that is associated with the transport of produce from the farmers to BOC. And we'll be able to, in the long term, we'd like to switch to local supplies as well, wherever possible, because that will be much more efficient. So for materials which are not that specific to an area, we can always switch there. Finally, the consortium which we have integrated with, we can scale up the use of the blockchain platform. So as discussed, the blockchain platform by Musk and IBM is currently being tested with a number of selected partners. So in a period of 6 years, we expect it to be mature to a certain extent. And according to this, once it is successfully tested, we'll launch our own pilot on this and then it will be followed up by scaling up to enrich port collaboration and improve terminal planning.